here we are, the film director Ole and the film photographer Ami and I on our way to Qumran at the Dead Sea to shoot a film on Aramaic, the sacred language of Yeshua, better known as Jesus. Since the late 80s, I've been studying the secrets of Aramaic, and today I'm going to show my fellow travelers the miraculous powers of an ancient Aramaic ceremony from the time of Yeshua. And I want to do it in one of the most sacred places on earth. The first time I visited Israel was in 1969 while touring the country for 3 months with the band Daisy. Chaim Saban was our manager and we played for Israeli soldiers as well as the Israeli and Arabic youth all over Israel. Right from the beginning I felt a strong and very special connection to this country. I simply felt that I belonged here and I was crying like a child the day we had to leave and go back to Denmark. I visited Israel again in 1978, taking the boat from Piraeus to Haifa. But once it became impossible to reach Israel by the sea, I didn't go for almost 40 years. It wasn't until I was married to Gita Ben David in 2010 that I took to flying again. Gita have lived in Israel for many years and have the same strong connection as I to this place. And now we visit Israel at least twice a year. The Dead Sea Scrolls have played an important part in my Aramaic studies. The scrolls were discovered in the caves around Qumran in 1947, and they can be traced back to the Essene brother and sisterhood that lived in the area. The scrolls were written in the period between 150 BC and the time when Yeshua entered the brotherhood for further education. Yeshua was simply the Messiah, the long-awaited reincarnated teacher of righteousness, whom the Essenes had expected for 200 years. Qumran is located just a stone's throw from the place in Jordan where Yohannan baptized Yeshua. It was shortly after that event that Yeshua came back to Qumran for his final initiation, 40 days in the desert. And the place where this happened is exactly where I want to take you.
The highlight of the trip was in the cave in Qumran. What happened in the cave is that we went there to perform a ceremony. I didn't know what the ceremony is going to be like. I've never been to this cave. And I was quite stripped from my gear since we had to climb our way to the cave. I had a little camera I knew very little about, not all the gear I'm used to. And we had the setup of the cave. We got there, and when Lara started the ceremony, something happened.
Secret mission is on. We'll see if we manage.
This is the cave.
That shouldn't be that difficult.
What you see here is cave 4. It was here most of the Essenes skulls were found. American psychologist Helen Schuckman, who was the scribe of the Course in Miracles, had a vision in 1969, the same year I first visited Israel. A vision of a cave in which she found an old scroll. When she opened the scroll, she read the words, "God is." 4 years later, in 1973, she visited Qumran, and when she stood on this exact spot, looking towards the cave, she suddenly became very moved, and as told by her old friend, Kenneth Wapnick, pointed to the cave before bursting into tears. "This is the cave from my vision. This is the holiest place on earth." In the book of Hosea from the Old Testament, this place is also called the Gate of Hope. And this is where I plan to do the old ceremony. It is the third time I visit Cave 4, the Gate of Hope. It's a very special and powerful place, but it's certainly not an easy climb. In fact, it is quite dangerous, as there's nothing to cling onto while you're trying to climb the wall. You just have to pray and concentrate. So this is the cave number 4. That's the official name for this cave. And this was used for a specific purpose. And they were coming down here to spend 40 days in the desert. And 40 days in the desert were the Essenes, the first step before they went into the Merkabah state. The Merkabah state was like you put yourself in what they call the chariot of fire. And that was a transcended state of awareness. That meant that they could travel in time and space. and they could read in the Book of Life. But as I told you, this is also the place where Yeshua might have been sitting in his 40 days in the desert. And what was that all about? That meant they you came here to put yourself in an unprotected state. An unprotected state. And that's something that is completely strange to us today, because nobody wants to put themselves in an unprotected state. On the contrary, we really want to be assured, we want insurance of, on everything, we want to be protected, we don't want to put ourselves and just move out of the our comfort zone. But that was something they did deliberately. They came here and they sat down and they just waited. And after maybe a week, maybe two, all the wild animals gathered around them. As you can read in the New Testament, Yeshua was surrounded by wild animals, and those beasts were of course his own shadows. Everything that he needed to have a closer look on in himself slowly came to life. So he had to face himself, he had to face his own demons. So this is the perfect place to purify yourself. And after 40 days, just imagine to be in a place like this for 40 days. Remember, they had water, they had dates, maybe aloe vera or something like that, no more. And then they sat here, then the next step after they had purified themselves, the elevated state of consciousness opened up for them. The Essenes also knew about the angels, and that was their idea of trying to explain the energies that surround man. But the four grandest of those energies, of those angel energies, was the four archangels: Michael, Gabriel, Uriel, and Raphael. All the four names have an ending of L, and L is God. So those four forces are part of the of creation. They have been there always. They were here, and they were part of the creation for the benefit of us.
As Lars was performing the ceremony, singing, after a few minutes, the light started to perform, to communicate with us, with Lars. I wasn't sure that I'm seeing this or imagining this, so I tried to explore that as much as I can with the camera.
The ceremony is an old Kabbalistic prayer from the time of the Essenes, but only the first six lines of the prayer are known. The seventh and last one is secret, since those who knew of its power wanted to protect the prayer from being misused. After many years of searching for the missing link to complete the prayer, I found it in the holiest spot of all, in the secret chamber of the human heart. The missing link would have to be the Messiah, the anointed one, the chosen one, deep within man himself. Therefore, the last line must be Veba Levi Mashiach, or Veba Levi Yeshua. Veba Levi Mashiach, and in my heart, the Messiah. Or Veba Levi Yeshua, in my heart, Jesus. Every time I come here, I do a little ceremony in order to pay my respect to those energy forces, because in the Western world where I come from, we used to think that everything can be handled mentally. We don't know that ceremony or prayer or things like that have any effect, but it really is the difference between just thinking and doing.
Oh.
B’SHM ADONAI, B’SHM ADONAI. Mi ameni Michael, mi ameni Michael. Umismoli Gabriel, umismoli Gabriel. Umilifanai Uriel, umilifanai Uriel. Umiachorai Raphael, umiachorai Raphael. Ve'aroshi Shekinah, ve'aroshi Shekinah. Ve'baleli Yeshua, ve'baleli Yeshua. B’SHM ADONAI, B’SHM ADONAI, mi ameni Michael, mi ameni Michael, umismoli Gabriel, umismoli Gabriel, umilifanai Uriel, umismoli Lanin, umiachorai Raphael, umismoli Lanin. Ve'aroshi Shekinah, ve'aroshi Shekinah. Ve'baleli Yeshua, ve'baleli Yeshua. B’SHM ADONAI, B’SHM ADONAI.
The timing when Lars finished the song and the sun appeared from the corner of the pier and spread its light in the cave, the timing was so perfect, and the show that came and the energy and what happened in the cave, this was an epiphany. It was very clear to me that we were there for a reason. We were in the right place, in the right time, on the right track.
While Lars was in the cave, I was outside filming. Then suddenly I heard this very strange sound, boosted by the echo from the valley. At first I was thinking it was the Israeli Air Force, operating drones or something like that. But looking up, I saw birds at high speed, counting 12 doves, passing the cave, disappearing into the sky. In a moment the first rays of sun appeared above the horizon. It felt like a blessing.
What happened here in the time of Yeshua is really beyond comprehension. This place is a sacred gateway and has always been a gateway to translated states of being. And in the end, we all have to pass through that gate of transfiguration to enter that secret and sacred place in our hearts, to become pure light, pure compassion, to become who we really are. Oh God.